Hello and welcome to this talk. I'm going to talk about alternative construction of asymmetric primitives from obfuscation. This is a joint work with Georg Fussbauer and Pouya Farchim, and I'm Alain Passeleg. So let me start by explaining a bit this long title. So we construct alternative construction in the sense that the results we prove are already known from similar assumptions. We just propose alternative way of getting these results, and we focus on asymmetric primitives. So we build in particular public key encryption, identity-based encryption, Hive and predicate encryption, and all our constructions are based on obfuscation. So I'm going to start by explaining what is obfuscation, and in the paper we use indistinguishability obfuscation, which is a primitive that allows to transform some circuit C into a new circuit C tilde, which is the obfuscated circuit, that is functionally equivalent to the original circuit. So this is for correctness. And the security property is that if you start with two circuits C and C prime that are functionally equivalent, then their obfuscations are computationally indistinguishable. So you might have heard that I/O is crypto complete, and this is something that is said often in the sense that if you have I/O, then you can build almost all crypto assuming only one-way function. So our results are following this line of works, proving that you can build a lot from I/O. So I'm just going to give you a brief overview of the story of obfuscation. So indistinguishability obfuscation was first constructed based on multi-maps in 2013, so with a candidate construction. And since then, the status of the existence of I/O has been quite unclear because we have had a lot of progress, but also a lot of attacks and fixes. And so it was still unclear until recently whether obfuscation exists or not. And during these years of research, still some major results came up. In particular, in 2017, it was proven that assuming only LWE, we can obfuscate what we call compute and compare programs, which are programs with a function hardwired and two values y and z hardwired, such that on input x, the program checks whether f of x is equal to y, and in that case, return the hardwired value z, otherwise, it just reveals nothing. So this was a really nice result, but actually in the recent months, new construction of obfuscation came up, and we have now construction of general obfuscation from relatively well-founded assumption, and it's likely that obfuscation exists now. Okay, so I'm not talking anymore about positive results on obfuscation, but let's jump into the construction that we have in the paper. So the starting point of our paper is a simple PK construction that is analogous to a construction we had in a paper in 2016, and that is inspired by the witness encryption-based construction of public key encryption from Garg et al. In 2013. So for this public key encryption construction, the ingredients are the following. So we have a length doubling PRG and an indistinguishability obfuscator. And so just as a reminder, a PRG is just a primitive that takes as input some uniformly random strings of length n. And so if it's length doubling, it outputs a string of length 2n that is computationally hard to distinguish from a random value of length 2n, random string of length 2n. Okay, so how do we get PKE from these two ingredients? So it's very simple. The secret key is just a PRG seed, so uniformly random string of length n, and the public key is the output of the PRG on this secret key, so G of SK. And so now to encrypt, you just encrypt a kind of compute and compare program that has the message and the public key hardwired, and that on input S, just check that S is a preimage of the public key for the PRG, and in that case, it returns the message, otherwise doesn't reveal anything about the message. So of course, to decrypt even such a ciphertext, you just run the obfuscated circuit on input the secret key, and if the secret key matches the public key, you have G of SK equal PK, and then you get the message. So correctness is immediate. And now for in-CPS security, what we want is to prove that encryption of first message M0 is indistinguishable from an encryption of a message M1. And so to do that, we can take the obfuscated circuit with M0 hardwired in it, and switch in this obfuscated circuit the value of PK that is hardwired to hardwired instead a uniformly random string. And this is possible thanks to the security of the PRG. And then if we take a uniformly random string of length 2n with good probability, with overwhelming probability, this will not be in the range of G, and then this circuit is going to be always outputting bottom. So using I/O security now, you can show that this obfuscated circuit is indistinguishable from an obfuscated circuit that doesn't contain any information of the message about the message, but just always outputs bottom. And so now to go back to a circuit that contains M1, we can just do the reverse way. And so it's easy again, assuming I/O security plus PRG to get back to the obfuscated circuit that contains M1. And so we get in CPS security very simply. So a couple of remarks on this public key encryption scheme. So first, I mentioned that this is kind of a compute and compare program. So in particular, this is a compute and compare program in the sense of the definition I gave you before. But actually, for the LWB-based obfuscation of compute and compare program, we need the value y to which we compare f of x to be low entropy. And so in our case, y is the public key, which is g of sk. And so it has a high entropy because it's the output of a PRG on a uniformly ordered string. So unfortunately, we cannot use the LWB-based obfuscation construction to do that. But we'll see that actually we can still manage to instantiate this on a standard assumption. Another remark is that the public key being pseudo-random, the scheme, it's very easy to prove that it achieves anonymity. I'm not going to do it, but this will be the case for all the schemes actually that we have. Okay, so as I said, even though we cannot use the LWB-based obfuscation because the entropy of PK is high, we can still instantiate this on a very simple assumption, which is DDH. So this is one thing we do in the paper. So basically, we use a DDH-based PRG, which is the standard DDH-based PRG defined as follows. And so what we achieve is building a statistical obfuscator for circuits that correspond to the encryption circuit, so if that checks if you know a preimage for this PRG of the public key, and in that case, return the message. So the main idea for this obfuscator is that instead of checking that the g of s and h of s for the input that you're feeding to the circuit is equal to the public key, so I'm denoting the public key x and y, you can check a randomized linear combination of g and h. So you take random alpha and beta, and so if g of s, h of s is equal to xy, it implies that g to the alpha times h to the beta, everything to the power s is equal to x alpha times y beta. So doing this kind of a randomized linear combination of g, h, and xy, you can actually hide the information and you get a statistical obfuscator. And so in the end, the obfuscated circuit that we get as the form defined on the left side of this slide. So this is just four group elements. And so actually the scheme we get is very similar to L-gamma encryption with anonymity. So the scheme in the paper is slightly different, but this is still the overall idea of the scheme. Okay, so let's go back to the generic PKE construction and let's try to now extend this to more advanced primitives. So the encryption circuit, I'm happy with it. I'm not going to change it, but I'm going to look at the secret key and the public key. So what happens is that the secret key is a uniformly random string. So in particular, maybe we could change the secret key to be the output of some PRF. So let's say instead of taking it completely uniform, I'm just defining as fk of 0, where fk is some PRF with key k. And so now doing so, I can define tons of other secret keys. So for instance, sk1 is fk of 1, sk2 is fk of 2, and still we have corresponding public keys that correspond to evaluate the PRG on these secret keys. So in some sense, now I have some huge family of secret keys and public keys pair that are all linked to some master secret key, which is k, right, the PRF key. And so if I manage to get some master public key that allows anyone to get the corresponding public key PKI for some index I, then I would immediately get an IB scheme keeping the same encryption circuit. So this is actually what we show. So basically what happens for our IBE construction, so the master secret key is a PRF key, so uniformly random string. The master public key is some way to get this PKID that I will come back to later. And so the secret key for an identity is just the PRF evaluation on the input, the targeted, the this identity, and with key the master secret key. And so the encryption scheme, the encryption circuit is the same as before, except that we use the public key of the target identity instead of the single public key that existed in the PKE scheme. And so the main thing that remains to do is how to get this master public key that allows us to get this public key for each identity. So this is we solve it doing using obfuscation again. So the master public key is just an obfuscated circuit that contains the master secret key, so the PRF key, and so on input the ID just return the public key corresponding to this ID, so G of MF of MSK of ID. Okay, so again, correctness is immediate. And so for in-CPA security, we can almost use the same proof as for the PKE scheme, except that you need to make sure that the secret key of the targeted entity in the proof is random, which is not the case anymore because the secret key of the targeted entity is some PRF evaluation. So the first thing we need to do in the proof is to puncture the PRF to make SKID star uniform, and then we can apply the same proof as the PKE construction. So a couple of remarks again, it's still anonymous, same reason as before. And another remark is that the encryption circuit is exactly the same as before, so in particular we could instantiate this using DDH as before, but there is one additional obfuscated circuit in the construction, which is the master public key. And this master public key is an obfuscation that performs both a PRG and a PRF evaluation, and this we don't know how to get except using general obfuscation so far. Okay, so let's try to generalize even further, and in particular, the next target is going to be HIBE, hierarchical IBE. So if I sum up the IBE construction so far, I have a master secret key, which is a PRF key. I have identity keys that are evaluation of the PRF key, of the PRF with the master secret key as a key, and input the identity. And the corresponding public key is just PRG evaluation of the secret key. And the master public key is some obfuscated circuit that makes what we want. So the question to get HIBE is how to add levels to this hierarchy. So here you have just a master secret key and one level of IDs. So I'm going to assume a simpler case. So I'm going to consider the IBE construction with two identities. So you have the master secret key, which is the PRF key K, and two secret keys for each identity that are evaluation of the PRF on input 0 and on input 1. So let's say now I want to add a level of in the hierarchy defining the HIBE. So basically, I want to add new keys that the user that know FK0 and FK1 can generate. So the idea now is just to view FK0 and FK1 as uniformly random strings, so as new PRF keys, and so you can evaluate using these new PRF keys the PRF again, and so you can create a second layer as the first one by just evaluating the PRF with K, K0 or K1 on input 0 and 1. This gives us a new layer of secret keys, so a new layer of users that are below in the hierarchy, because if you know one of the two keys at the first layer, you can generate two of the keys on the second layer, and you can repeat the process, and in the end what you get is a binary tree based hierarchy where each user can generate all the keys of the user that are below him in the tree. So this corresponds actually to the GGM constraint PRF. This is actually the idea of the GGM constraint PRF, and the property of this constraint PRF is that given a node in this tree, so for instance given K11 here, that is now in blue, then you can compute all the nodes that are in the subtree rooted in K11, so the subtree in red, but still all the things in the tree that remain black looks random to you if you know K11. So combining this tree-based structure with the previous IDs for the IBE construction, what we get is a HIBE where the master secret keys for the hierarchy are defined as follows. So the top level key in the tree is the master secret key, and the key for each identity corresponds to a key in this tree. So the depth of the identity corresponds to how high the identity is in the hierarchy, and the rest of the construction still works as in the IBE case. So public key of identities correspond to the evaluation of the PRG on the secret keys of these identities. The master public key is some circuit obfuscated with the master secret key hardwired in it that allows you to get PK of IDs. And overall, this gives you a bounded HIBE construction. So now the good news is that we can even extend this further to get predicate encryption. So the idea is the same. So the master secret key is going to be a constraint PRF key. The master public key is going to be the obfuscated circuit that allows you to get PRG evaluation of the PRF evaluation on some attribute gamma of your choice. And so now to encrypt a message with attribute gamma, what you do is just obfuscate the circuit the same as before. So this circuit basically just makes sure that someone who runs it can get the message if and only if he knows a preimage for the public key corresponding to the attribute gamma. And so now a secret key for some predicate P is just a constraint key for the PRF that allows you to get PRF evaluation on input gamma if and only if P of gamma is equal to 1. So in the end, what happens is that if you have a CPRF for all circuits, so if you use a CPRF for all circuits as F, then what you get is predicate encryption for circuit. So I'm actually I'm cheating a bit here. The construction is slightly more involved than that, but the overall idea is really that. The core idea is really this. Okay, so now I'm gonna conclude the talk by explaining the main technical result that we achieve in the paper, which is getting unbounded HIBE. So first, as a reminder, the difference between bounded and unbounded HIBE is that in bounded HIBE, the length of any identity is bounded at setup, while in unbounded HIBE, the length of an identity, in particular the depth of the identity in the tree-based construction I gave you, would be unbounded. So this gives us several challenges, as the first one is that we use so far circuits, and circuits cannot take unbounded inputs. So maybe a solution would be to use Turing machines that can take arbitrary large input, and then use indistinguishability obfuscation for Turing machine. That's actually not what we do, and the reason is that there are even problems if we do that. In particular, there are two other problems that are related. And the first one is that when we do the proof, we need to rely on the PRF security for the key corresponding to identity star, the target identity. And so to switch this PRF evaluation to a uniformly random value, we need to make sure that it comes from a PRF where the key is also uniformly random. And so basically we need to, the simple solution is to replace all the keys from the path to the root, from the root to the target identity by random values. So if we do that, unfortunately, the thing is that we will need to hardwire all these keys from the root to the target identity in the circuit to replace them by uniformly random keys. And so we will need to hardwire an unbounded quantity of uniformly random keys in the circuit. And so since it's unbounded, we don't know how much the original circuit needs to be padded for the proof to work. So there is a solution to that, which is to use what we call pebbling. So pebbling allows us to only change locally the path from the root to the target identity. And using pebbling, you actually need to hardwire only a logarithmic number of keys, where the logarithmic number in the depth of the target identity. And so doing this strategy, you can hardwire only a limited quantity of information in the circuit, and so we can have the construction. But still there is a problem, because when we do pebbling, we need to know which locations are affected by the pebbling at any time. And so to do that, we need to store the positions of the in the tree where we use the hardwired values instead of the actual keys. And so these positions are also unbounded, and that we don't know how to make them bounded. So still, since we need to hardwire these positions, we don't have enough space. We don't know how much space we need in advance to make the proof work. So we actually do something different in the end. So the construction works as follows. So we get unbounded HIBE from obfuscation of only circuits. And so the idea is the following. So the first idea is that instead of having unbounded, to handle the unbounded identities, what we do is that we hash the identities. So hashing the identities fix their length, so we don't have any issue with circuits having to work with unbounded length inputs. And so now the public keys corresponding to some identity is not defined as g of fk of the identity, but rather as g of fk of h, where h is the hash of the identity. So the issue with this new way of defining the keys is that this completely destroys the hierarchical tree-based structure that we had before. And so now the question is how to make sure that someone who knows a key in the tree that is defined by the identities is able to get a key for a descendant, or not able to get a key for something that is not a descendant. So to do that, we now provide a new circuit, an obfuscated circuit, that makes sure that if a user knows a secret key for such for a certain identity and can prove that is asking for the key for a descendant of his identity for which he now approves, then he can still get the secret key of this identity. So to do that, we use snarks. So we ask the user to produce a snark proof, a valid proof that the identity for which is asking a new secret key is also an identity that is a descendant of the identity that for which he knows the key, and then if so, he can get the key for this identity. So Overall construction is quite complex, and the proof in particular still uses pebbling to handle the unbonded hardwiring. I'm suggesting you to look at the paper if you want more details. This is actually not completely straightforward, but this, I think there are a lot of nice ideas in the construction. So with this, I'm concluding the talk, and thank you for watching.